The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my share and portion be as long as life.
Let's say it's good to be coming your way today. We appreciate, you know, you watching. Appreciate everybody that watches and everybody that calls us and tells us that you watch, and people that we see out every week that tells us we watch. You know, they watch. We appreciate it. We want to make this announcement real quick. The first Saturday night of next month, I believe we're going to have Paula New Creation come into it's Lacy's Chapel, and which if you watch this station, you see them. They're really good. They'll be at our church the first Saturday night of next month at 6 o'clock, and they're really good. And we give you an invitation to come be with us. But we give you an invitation to come be with us at Lacy's Chapel at Henniger, Alabama. Go to the Henniger Crossing, go Highway 40 west like you're going to Scottsboro. And after the crossing, the church is about 3 miles on the left. Or if you're coming from Scottsboro, you go past Storage Trucking, and it's about a mile on the right. But, you know, I want to say this. We're having every week visitors. Every week we have visitors that's coming to our church, and I just want to thank you. I want to thank all the people that was there Sunday. We had visitors. We're just so thankful that you chose to come and be with us, and we're really thankful that you're coming to being with us and being part of our services. And we had a wonderful time Sunday. I mean, we had a great service and had, you know, a large amount of people there. God is blessing our church. Man, I want to tell all the visitors that they watch the program, and I sure do appreciate you watching, and I was so thankful to see you, and you just tickled to death, you know, just to have you, and our whole church was. I appreciate all the visitors that came and all the families that came, and we're just thrilled, you know, just really happy to have you, and come back and be with us, and you'll always be welcome. You seen how friendly everybody was Sunday. They're that way every Sunday. I've been pastoring a long time, and this is the friendliest church I've ever pastored. If you're watching and you don't have a church and you'd like to go somewhere that you'd be wanted, that you'd be welcome, that they would love you and treat you good, come be with us at Lacy's Chapel. Like I said, go to Henniger Crossing. Go Highway 40 West like you're going to Scottsboro. And church will be 3 miles on your left, right at 3 miles. I mean, if you're coming from Scottsboro, we got people from comes to our church from that way also. You go past Storage Truck, and it'll be about a mile on your right. We'd love to have you. It just thrills me every time that we have visitors and they tell us they're watching the program. We just love it. And the whole church is really thrilled to have everybody that comes. You wouldn't go anywhere that you'd be more welcome or more appreciated. And I want to thank, again, all the families that came Sunday. And we're so glad to have you. And we had a good service Sunday, and normally we have good services. So we give you that invitation, Lacy's Chapel, Sunday school at 10, preaching at 11, Wednesday night at 6:30. We give you that invitation to come be with us and just have a good time in the Lord together. But if you got your Bible, and I want to send this program out, my cousin John, he watches every week, and he had a birthday, and I want to wish him a happy birthday, and wish it to him a few days late. And we're having the ordination service Sunday night at 6 o'clock, where we want to ordain some deacons, and we'll be glad to have you for that also. So if you got your Bibles, turn to John chapter 16, verse 7. We're still talking about the things we're talking about that God has prepared for us. And we talked about the Holy Spirit, how God has given us the Holy Spirit to help us last week. But I want to look at work of the Holy Spirit today, a different aspect of the Holy Spirit. And I forgot my watch, Matthew. You'll have to tell me when the time. I was in a hurry this morning. But in the 16th chapter of John, we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit. And it's going to be great. This is really going to be good. And John chapter 16, verse 7, he says, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth." Here's what Jesus said. "It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter or the Helper will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you." So Jesus, and we all know how great Jesus is, the Son of God, the healer. You know, he saves people, he heals people, he delivers people. But Jesus said to his disciples, it's advantageous. The word expedient means advantageous or beneficial or profitable or better. In other words, he's saying it's better for you. It's profitable for you that I go away, because if I go away, I'll send your helper to you. And he's talking about the Holy Ghost. But Jesus said, and we have to really get our minds around that just for a minute. Jesus said, it's to your advantage that I go away. Because if I don't go back to my Father, I can't send your helper unto you. Well, why did Jesus say that? Well, one reason was, you know, Jesus would preach in one town, and he said in one verse, I must go to other towns. He'd preach in one town and go to one town and another town. He was at one place at one time while he was here on earth. But the Holy Ghost is everywhere. Yeah, the Holy Ghost is everywhere. He's helping everybody in every church, on every continent. You know, he is worldwide. He's helping all of God's children. Jesus was at one place at one time doing miracles. But the Holy Ghost is everywhere. But Jesus said it was to our advantage that he go away, that he could send our helper. Now, verse 8 says, here's what I'm going to talk about. This is going to be really good. Now, I mean, this is going to be really, really good. Jesus said, I'm going to read verse 8. He said, and when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Now, let me read that again. When he has come, the word reprove means to convict. When he has come, he will convict the world of sin. So, Jesus is saying that the Holy Ghost is going to convict the people of sin. Well, just say this to start with. You can't get saved until you realize you're lost. You'll never be born again till you realize that you're lost, that you're not right with God. That's the first step of being born again. You have to realize that you're lost. But not only does the Holy Ghost convict a lost person, you know, Jesus said, no man comes to the Father. You know, he said he'd be drawn. He has to be drawn by the Spirit. Well, the Holy Ghost is the one that convicts a lost person. If you're watching me, now listen to what I'm going to say, because this is going to be really important. If you're watching me and you're a Christian, you got saved because the Holy Ghost convicted you that you was lost. You got saved because of the Holy Ghost convicting you that you was lost. See, there wouldn't be any salvation without the Holy Ghost. He has to convict you. He has to convict a lost person that is lost. He's the one that convicts it. Jesus said, and when he has come, talking about the Holy Ghost, he will convict the world of sin. Well, not only does the Holy Ghost convict a lost person, but he draws them to God. He puts that desire in their heart to get right with God. So we need to really stop and realize just how important the Holy Ghost is in our salvation. He convicted us that we was lost, and he drew us unto God. The Holy Ghost did that. Jesus said that. Well, not only that, but the Holy Ghost convicts that the Christian of sin. You know, now I want to show you this. This is really good. You know, if you're a Christian and you've been saved, and I'm talking for a moment to the Christians, and you've been saved, the one thing in your life, the one thing in your life that will absolutely destroy you is sin. You have one thing in this world that you have to fight again. It will destroy you. It will rob you. It will steal from you. Of course, that's Satan, but Satan uses sin. He tempts people to sin. Sin is the enemy, is the thing that Satan uses to steal from a Christian. Well, there's nothing good that comes out of sin. Well, Satan tempts people to sin because the Word of God says Satan is two things. We know of two things that he is. Number one, he's a liar. Satan will offer a believer, show a believer something that's again the will of God, contrary to the Word of God, and tell him if you'll do this, you'll enjoy it, you'll have a good time. He's a liar. He's also a deceiver. He'll show a lost person or a Christian. He'll show a Christian something that is totally forbidden in the Word of God. And he'll tell them, if you'll do this, you're going to enjoy life and you're going to have a good time. But it's not what the Word of God says sin produces. Well, he is also a deceiver. He'll tell a Christian, well, you're a child of God. You know, you can do what you want to. Well, you know, there's a consequence to sin. Sin brings a consequence. So Romans chapter 2, here's what he says. Now listen to what God says about sin. But we have to understand that the Holy Ghost is who convicts us of sin. The Holy Ghost is who is living in us that tells us you're sinning. This is wrong. You're sinning. The Holy Ghost is the convictor. Jesus said he was. Said when he has come, he will convict you of sin. So let's look right here real quickly and see what sin produces in the life of a believer. Because I want everybody to get this, because this is going to be really important. It says, but them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness. So God is saying, we're to obey God, but they are people that obey unrighteousness. They live unrighteous. They do what's unrighteous. They live an unrighteous lifestyle, and they obey unrighteousness. See, verse 6, Romans 2 and 6 says, who will render to every man according to his deeds? Well, there's people that get saved, and they live for God, and there's people that totally reject God. Well, when you stand before God, if you got saved and lived for God, God's going to bless you. He's going to reward you. But if you reject God, Jesus preached on hell more than any other person in all of the Bible. Who preached on hell the most? Jesus did. He says, Romans 2 and 7 says, to them who by patient continuance and well-doing seek for glory, honor, immortality, eternal life. You know, it talks about people that living for God, that seeking God, that serving God. Verse 8, but to them that are contentious, and that word means self-seeking, they're going to do their own thing. I'm my own man. I'm going to do my own thing. I'll do my own thing my own way. It's all about them. He says, but to them who are contentious, that means self-seeking. It means they're going to do their own thing, their own way, their own time. Listen. And do not obey the truth, but obeys unrighteousness. Now listen to what God says sin brings. Listen to what God says sin brings. Indignation, wrath, tribulation, and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil. Here is what. Now listen to me. This is good. This is what God says sin brings. He says to the Jew first and also to the Gentile. Don't matter if you're Jew or Gentile. This is what sin brings. This is the payday of sin. This is the fruit of sin. This is what it brings. Here's what it says, indignation. That word means intense displeasure, anger, or rage. Have you ever seen anybody just absolutely miserable? That's the definition of indignation. It means anger, wrath, or intense displeasure. You've seen people, they're just miserable. I mean, they don't serve God. They curse. They have no plans on serving God. They're absolutely miserable. That's what God says sin brings. But Satan is a deceiver. He didn't tell Eve, if you eat of that fruit right there, one of your boys is going to kill the other boy. I mean, you're going to do a lot of weeping and you're going to do a lot of crying. There's going to be a lot of pain. He didn't tell her that. He told her, you eat that fruit, you'll be as God. He lied and he deceived her. That's what he still does. You know, Satan don't tell a young man about drugs. You're going to get hooked on it. You're going to lose your job. You're going to lose your wife. You're going to lose your kids. You're going to go to jail. You're going to ruin your name. Your mother and dad is going to sit night after night crying and praying. You're going to bust their heart. Satan doesn't tell that man that. What he tells them is, man, you're going to enjoy this. You're going to have a good time. Well, he's a liar and the deceiver. God says sin brings indignation. It means anger, wrath, or extreme or intense displeasure. There's no joy in sin. The Bible said there's a pleasure of sin for a season, for a short time. But that season is just for a small time, and then you get the results of sin is indignation. The second one is wrath, and it means anger or hostility. Sin brings hostility. It brings anger and hostility. This is what God says sin brings. There's a lot of hostile people in the world. There's a lot of people that are angry. You know, the fruit of the Spirit is joy, love, and peace. The fruit that the Holy Ghost produces in the life of a believer is peace. You're going to get along with people. Well, I'm full of the Holy Ghost. Well, you're going to get along with people. You're going to get along with people. You're going to get along with your church members if you're full of the Spirit. Sin brings hostility, anger, malice, intense displeasure. The third thing that sin brings is tribulation. That word means trouble. It means trouble. God said, if you sin, trouble's coming. If you sin, trouble is coming. You know, Satan will say, well, man, you know, you take these drugs, you're going to be happy. You're going to be fine. Everything, you're going to enjoy it. Man, you'll be cool then. He doesn't tell you that it brings intense displeasure, hostility, and trouble. Now look at the last one. Anguish means hardship or difficulty. God says sin produces hardships, it produces difficulty, and it produces trouble. This is the definition of Strong's Concordance of what sin brings in a Christian's life. It brings hardship, difficulty, or trouble. Well, now listen to me. Please don't get mad at me. Just stay with me a minute. Let me just give one example. The Bible says, fail not the assembling of yourselves together. Well, what is sin? It's breaking the law. It's breaking the word of God. That is what sin is. It's breaking God's commandments. That is what sin is. It's breaking God's commandments. It's sin. Well, if God says, when you have church, I want you in church. And you say, well, I would, but, you know, Aunt so-and-so, I need to bake her a cake. And Brother Jimmy's nephew's uncle's cousins, he's coming in. We're going to go by and see them. Well, you start making excuses for layout of church. Here's what God said it's going to bring in your life. Hardship, difficulty, trouble. When you disobey God, trouble's coming. Hardships are coming, difficulties are coming. This is what the Word of God says sin brings. And I just used one example there. You know, the Bible tells us not to judge people. If you set up and you said you're Holy Ghost Junior, you're going to judge everybody. What's it going to bring in your life? Anger, trouble, hardship, and difficulties. Because you're disobeying the Word of God. This is why Jesus said one of the works. Now listen to me. One of the things that the Holy Ghost does in the life of a believer is to convict them of sin. You know, the Bible says we don't convict people of sin. It's not my job to convict people of sin. I preach God's word. It's not your job. God ain't got nobody in the church convicting people of sin. Our job for us is, the Bible said, examine yourselves and see whether or not you be in the faith. You know, God ain't got a troubleshooter in the church. That's one of the gifts that's not in there. God tells you to examine yourself to see whether you're in the faith. The Holy Ghost's job is to convict people of sin. That's not a person's job. And if a person starts doing that, they're out of the will of God and they grieve the Holy Ghost when they do it. But, so we see that sin brings hardship, difficulty, trouble, and anger. That's what sin brings. Well, there are a lot of angry Christians. There are a lot of people that goes to church in their heart, they're angry. You know why? Because they have unforgiveness in their heart. They've been hurt and they never dealt with it, and they have anger in their heart. You can go to church every Sunday and be an angry Christian and talk about people and try to find people's faults. You can do that. I pastored churches a long time. I've had people in my churches like that. They were angry. They had never totally forgiven. The Bible says sin brings anger, trouble, hardship, and difficulty. Now, here's what I want to say to you. Now, don't you listen to me just for a moment. I want everybody to listen to me because I'm talking to everybody. Would you want any of this? Now listen what I'm going to say to you. Would you want any of this in your life? You don't. You don't. Don't nobody. Would you want anger, hardship, difficulty, trouble, hostility in your children's life? No. You wouldn't. And if you listen to me. If you've seen your children doing something that was going to bring hardship, difficulty, anger, hostility, trouble in their life, you'd warn them. You'd warn these children. Why would you warn their children? Because you love them. Well, when God, now listen to what I'm going to say to you. When God sees me and you, when God sees me and you headed down the road, and that road leads us into sin, the Holy Ghost will convict us. Why does the Holy Ghost convict us? Because God loves us. God don't want you to have anger. God doesn't want you to have hostility. God doesn't want you to have trouble. God doesn't want you to have difficulties or oppression. Jesus said, I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Jesus said, I come for you to have a good life. I've come for you to enjoy life. That's why Jesus taught over and over and over and over and over and over about forgiving people. Because unforgiveness is a sin. And it brings hardship, trouble, anger, difficulty, oppression. That's why it's so important to forgive people. Because if you don't, and I mean you totally hadn't settled it. You totally haven't settled it in your heart. When you totally forgive, you're set free. But until you totally do forgive, and you got unforgiveness in your heart, you're going to have trouble and anguish and heartache and suffering. All that's what sin produces. And unforgiveness is a sin. And that's what it will produce in anybody's life. I'm talking to every single person watching. Because all of us, listen, every single one of us have been hurt, and we've been hurt bad. Are we angry? Are we hostile? Are we out hunting people's faults? Well, when you do that, you grieve the Holy Ghost. That's not your job. That's the Holy Ghost's job. The Holy Ghost's job is to correct people, not you, or not me, or no anybody else. That's the Holy Ghost's job. But I want to ask you this. Maybe you're watching. Maybe you're watching today and you've really been hurt. Now, I want to talk to you just for a minute. And all of us have. Have you totally forgiven? And I'm going to pray. And I want you to pray with me. If you're watching and somebody has, I mean, they've ripped your heart out. I want you to pray with me. Say, Father, I come to you in Jesus' name and say, God, I choose to forgive. Father, that person that's hurt me, I choose to forgive. I asked you to forgive me, and Father, I choose to forgive. From this day forward, I choose to forgive. God, I give it to you. And so in Jesus' name we ask this, amen. If you prayed that, you've asked God to forgive you, and you have forgave, God has set you free. He'll replace that anger with joy. He'll replace that broken heart with peace. Jesus said, I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Get a chance. Come be with us Sunday at Lacy's Chapel. We'd love to have you. We'd absolutely love to have you. Come be with us. May God bless you. Goodbye.